Okay, so it should be recording, but sadly, I don't think I can give you. I'm not sure if I can give you the authorization to record yourself because this is on the university Zoom account, and so I don't have the permission there. But I'm recording on my machine, so hopefully everything will be uploaded afterwards. So this is the expert tutorial, let's say. And so Pierre-Henri and myself, we are mostly interested in doing parallel computing, and the aim of this tutorial, let's say, is to try to give you the feeling of what's going on under the hood, because of course you can just try to launch one of the many examples there on Prefem, but maybe, I mean, we think it's best to try to teach you how it actually works. And so then it's easier for you to try to adapt your example and try to run your code in parallel yourself. So as I said this morning, for actually doing the tutorial, it's quite straightforward. Give me a sec. Il y a un petit souci de. Ok, ça doit être mieux. So you can just go to freefem.org. Ok. Then you can just. So you need to go. Hop. You need to go inside. You can go to source code. Ok. Then on source code, you will be redirected to the GitHub repository of Prefem, and then you can just, you should be able to access the release. Okay, and so the release, you can see that the last version was released 2 months ago, approximately, and so you can just download either the package if you are running on macOS, or the .exe if you are running on Windows, or the .deb if you are running on Ubuntu or Debian derivative, let's say. And so I will try to be as comprehensive as possible, and I will actually, at least at the beginning, try to run both the scripts on my machine. So this is a Mac machine, okay? And I will also try to run the same code inside my Windows virtual machine. Okay, so this is the first time I'm doing this, and so maybe it will not work, so I will just stick to my Mac machine, but basically the idea is to show you that it's quite straightforward to use parallel computing either on a Mac or on a Debian or on a Windows or whatever, okay? We will try to explain to you how parallel computing works inside Prefem. And so I will just go back to this morning basic examples, let's say. And so we will first try something doing very, very simple stuff, and basically show you how we can, for example, dispatch a domain, okay, a computational domain, into multiple smaller domains, let's say, so that then you can run parallel, then you can do parallel computing, okay? Of course, you are more than welcome to follow along. I will try to type not too slowly, but also not too fast. So hopefully, if you are interested in doing the same experiment yourself on your machine, you should be able to follow along, okay? So the first example, it will be in 2D. Of course, one of the advantages of doing parallel computing is that you can do 3D, but it's easier for me to do FFGLUT in 2D. And so I will show you, let me just move. It's easier for doing the visualization in 2D. And so I will start with a 2D example. Okay, so we've seen this. If you are in the expert quotes, tutorial, the quote expert quote tutorial. I guess you know at least about the basics of Prefem, and variational formulation. And so I guess you know about the mesh data structure. And so I will call this mesh square TH. I will call this square mesh TH, sorry. And so I will start with something really, really simple. But again, we want to give you a feeling of what's going on under the hood. So then you can hopefully better adapt the strategies to your examples. Okay. Of course, if you have really specific questions, as Pierre-Henri said, feel free to just raise your hand and ask us anything. We are here to help you out. So of course this is really basic, but just to make sure that we understand each other, here we just want to start really simple with a square domain, and so we want to see that everything is working correctly. And so yes, we have indeed a square mesh. Okay, so here you're saying that we are using FreeFM++. And so what Pierre-Henri and myself said this morning is that most of the packages for doing parallel computing, at least in FreeFM, rely on what is called MPI, so the message passing interface. And so this is a distributed memory paradigm. And so I will actually explain to you what this means in the context of finite element code. Okay, so the first step when you want to do FreeFM parallel in FreeFM, let's say, is to switch from the FreeFM++ binary to another binary, which is called FreeFM++ MPI, okay? And so I think if you have a proper installation, you can even do FFMPI run, okay? So I will try both. And so then you need to supply dash n. So n usually stands for the number of processes. And so right now I just want to run a sequential script, but with FreeFM++ MPI instead of FreeFM++. Okay. And so this should work, I think. Okay. So this is for now. This is really, really trivial. But again, we want to show you how it's done from start to finish, so that it's easier for you afterwards to try to redo this stuff yourself and maybe improve your script. Okay. So now this is the big question: does it work on my Windows? So on Windows, it's a little bit more tricky because there is no FFMPI run. Okay. So for now, it's a purely sequential script. So I can just call FreeFM++ MPI, hopefully. And so the name of the script was square.edp. And so you can see here that I'm adding the flag WJ, which stands for with graphics. So the opposite is NW, no window. And usually it's also a good idea to put the minus NS, so no script, so that you don't have too much output when you launch the script. Okay, FreeFM++, okay, so it's a good start.
You're missing a dash before MPI. You're missing a dash before MPI.
Ah, yeah, right. Thank you. That was a bad start. Okay. So this is nice. So this is my. I'm not cheating. This is indeed Windows. So I can show you that. Okay, this is my Windows machine. No, this is not. Oh, and of course, you have to type this inside a command prompt. Okay, so you just launch a CMD and you should be good to go. So I didn't ask. So we are 40 people. Okay, that's a lot of people. Maybe I'm not sure if any of you are using actually Windows, but in any case, if some of you are, well, you can just follow along. Okay, so the first thing that that you need to that we do for you actually, but that I want to show you here, is to do what we call domain decomposition. And so the idea of message passing when you look at finite element method is to partition a mesh, an initial mesh, into smaller pieces on which FreeFM will be called. And so the idea is to decompose a large workload, so let's say a matrix assembly, to decompose it into smaller workloads, into smaller smaller subdomains. Okay, and so in FreeFM, there are multiple ways to do domain decomposition, but the primary way, let's say, is to rely on a graph partitioner. And so there are multiple graph partitioner. And so for example, one of them is Métis. Okay. So at the beginning of the tutorial, I will do only sequential script, let's say, so you can follow along even with a standard FreeFM, and then we will move to parallel computing. But again, we want to show you really how it's working from start to finish. Okay, so Métis is a kind of graph partitioner. You have to load it because it's not there by default. There are other graph partitioners such as Scotch and Parmetis, for example. So I'm just commenting the load because here we will just stick to Métis. Okay. So if you think about domain decomposition is simply a way of saying to each of the cells, each of the elements in the initial domain TH, to which process it will belong. Okay. So you can see that as a coloring problem. And so you need to color each of your triangles in 2D or each of your tetrahedrons in 3D. Okay. And so Métis, Scotch, and Parmetis, which are graph partitioner, can be used to just do that. That is partition a mesh. Okay. So these plugins can be used to actually partition a mesh, color a graph. And so I will show you here what it looks like, and so what will you be playing with when you will be doing actual domain decomposition, parallel computing, preconditioner, and so on, parallel matrix assembly.
There's a question about the performance of the different partitioners.
Okay. So Métis and Scotch are two sequential graph partitioner. And so they basically provide the same results. We will be able to see that afterward. And Parmetis is a parallel graph partitioner. So it will be only useful if you want to look at really extremely refined global mesh. So this is basically the main difference. So if you think just about this tutorial, there will be actually no difference at all between the three alternatives. Coloring a graph is basically saying to each element to which subdomain it will belong, and so we use a nice property of the finite element space of order zero. So we will define a F space, for example, let's call this PH of order zero, which is that the functions will be constant per element. Okay. So we can define, for example, a function color, okay? And so you know by the definition of the function element space P0 that color will be constant per element, okay? And so then the idea is to call Métis. So I think the API is called Métis Dual. And so I don't remember by heart the call, but it should be something like the mesh you want to partition, the function on which you want to store the partitioning, and then the number of partition you want to have in your graph. So I will just check split repo open source example plugin métis.edp métis dual. Okay, so I mixed the two parameters. It's first the finite element function and then the mesh. Okay. And so now I can just try to plot this function color. And we will see what this gives. Okay. So FreeFM++ square or FreeFM++ MPI or FFMPI run, everything is equivalent for now. So if you don't have FreeFM++ MPI, we will just do FreeFM, okay? No script because there will be a little bit too much output. And so this is the output we get. And okay, So of course, maybe you're an expert of FreeFM, but maybe you are not an expert of FFGLUT, so the graphical user interface. So just as a quick reminder, if you want to switch to 3D to 2D, you just need to press the three on your keyboard. If you want to fill the values of the function, you need to press F like fill. And if you want to display the values on the right hand side of your plot, you need to press V. And for the mesh, it's M. So M as mesh, V as value, F as fill, and 3 to go from 3D to 2D. Okay. And so we can see now that Métis has partitioned our original domain into 4 subdomains. So blue is 0. Blue is 2. Red is 3. Yellow is 0. And green is 1. So this is the basics, and the idea now, of course, is to, for example, partition the domain in as many processes or as many how many processes your machine can handle. So, for example, let's say I have a medium-sized machine, and so I will just partition this in 20. So of course I will need to increase slightly my size of the domain, otherwise we will get garbage, but I think you will quickly get the idea. And so this is the kind of mesh you get, okay? So there you go. So if you want to know a little bit about the algorithm used to do the mesh partitioning, they try to basically group up as many elements as together while trying to decrease the skeleton surface. So if you remember this morning talk by Frédéric, he was doing a mortar example with a skeleton. The idea of Métis and Scotch is to try to minimize the skeleton surface while having subdomain that are appropriately of the same size. So actually we can just try to quickly check the result with Scotch, and you will see that basically the performance, I mean at least the size of the subdomains and the structure of the domain decomposition, they will be somehow similar. So I think the API for Scotch is actually exactly the same. You need to switch from Métis Dual to Scotch. So one thing about Scotch is that it tends to generate subdomains which are slightly which have interface that are slightly more smooth, let's say. Métis tends to produce partitions that have really little jumps along the interfaces. It's no big deal in both cases. The principle behind the graph partitioner are the same. Okay. So of course, here we have a domain decomposition in 20 processes. Okay. And so I will just try to do the same on my Windows machine. FreeFM++. So the name was square.edp. Okay. Nice. So now I think you get you start to get the idea. What we will do basically is to have each process assigned a single subdomain. Okay. So at the beginning, still I want to stay as simple as possible, and so I will just show you the kind of tools we can use to do this partitioning, but then we will switch to parallel, and so everything will be done for you automatically. But again, I want to make the tutorial as easy as possible to understand from start to finish what is done under the hood for you in the various tools that are available to do parallel computing. So the thing that we need to do next is to actually partition the global mesh according to the graph coloring or the mesh partitioning that we get from Scotch or Parmetis. And so we can use a routine which is not so hard to master, but that you may not have encountered thus far. And this routine is called trunk. And so I will show you what it does. And so I will need a new mesh. Trunk will return a new mesh. Let's call this THBIS. Okay. And so for trunk, you have multiple set of variables that you need to feed as inputs. The first one will be the mesh. So the mesh from which you want to trunk. So trunk is short for truncate. You can remember of this like that. So you put first the mesh. And then you need to feed a Boolean expression, which evaluates to either true or false. And so when the Boolean expression evaluates to one, it means that you want to keep the element. So either the tetrahedron or the triangle or the edge, if you are doing mesh S or mesh L, you want to keep the element inside the output mesh. So I will just start with a really basic Boolean expression, which is one. So basically, we just copy the original mesh into the output mesh. Okay, so we will try that. And so I will just output on the terminal using the cout command. For example, the number of elements. So th, which is the original mesh, and thbis, which is the other mesh. Okay. Tac, and so of course those two values should be equal. Okay, so we've got the correct value, that's nice. And now the idea is to change the decomposition, and instead of having a really really simple Boolean expression, do something slightly more fancy. And the idea is simply to truncate one subdomain. And so, for example, you can do this using the difference between color and a given integer. So let's say that you have 20. So I will use a variable for the value 20 here. So I will say int and color. Okay. And so then what you can do is check for the difference between color and any given integer between 0 and n color minus 1. Okay, so keep in mind that here color is a finite element function, so you are dealing with scalar values, not integers, and so you need to compare the difference up to an epsilon, up to a machine epsilon. So let's do, for example, color minus 2, lower than machine epsilon, so 1 minus 5. Okay, so I don't know if it's color bracket bracket or just color, so we'll check. Okay, let's just run that. Okay, so it works, but of course we don't see what the result is, and so now we will see. Okay, so so this is the original domain, so a square, and so then you can just take split the domain apart into smaller pieces, for example using the trunk function. And so this is only one of the subdomains. Okay, so this is the green subdomain. And so just to make sure that it's working properly, we can actually do, for example, a simple loop. So I will remove this C out because of course now there is nothing to compare. And so you can do a loop, for example, I equal to 0 up to n color plus plus I. And so and so now of course instead of having 2 here, the ID is put I. Okay, and so I will just say to ffglut to wait a bit, because otherwise we will just see random colors popping up on screen. Okay, so this is the script, and let's try to run this in Windows actually. Tac. Okay, so this is one subdomain, another subdomain, and so on. Okay, so that's really the short introduction to parallel computing with finite elements. Whatever the tool you are using, whatever the finite element packages you are using, so it's the same if you do FireDrake, if you do MFEM, if you do LibMesh, whatever. The idea of distributed parallel computing with finite element is always the same. You have to partition a mesh using a graph partitioner, so Metis, Scotch, or Parmetis. There are some others, but they are less frequently used. And then pull apart each subdomain on multiple processes. Okay. So now we will actually show you how to do this in parallel. And so in parallel, of course, it's okay. So before showing you how to do this in parallel, I will show you. This is the expert tutorial, so I will show you some expert tools that may be useful even if you're not doing parallel computing. Of course, if you have questions, please do not hesitate to ask us in the chat or in private. We are here to help you. I'm not here to talk for 3 hours nonstop. So don't worry, everything is okay. One small trick which is interesting is what in the trunk function. Okay, so the trunk function, of course, it does not only apply to parallel computing. You can use the trunk function if you are doing a sequential script and you want to extract part of a global domain to have, for example, different physics on different part of the domain. Okay. So what's interesting when you do the trunk function with the trunk function is that you can ask FreeFM to give to you the the index of the elements that were used that were kept in the new mesh. Okay, so it may sound a little bit tricky or obscure, but I will give you a quick example. So there is a parameter which is called new to old. Okay, which gives as an input a list of integers which are the indices of the new triangles inside the old mesh. Okay, so again, maybe it's not clear, but don't worry, it's only the beginning of this function. So as I told you, it gives you a list of integers. So a list of integers is basically an array of integers. And so in FreeFM, you probably know that an array of whatever the variable is written as x bracket int. So this is an array of x. So for example, a matrix int, mesh int, mesh 3 int, mesh 3 int, so on and so forth. Okay. So you've got an array that we call new to old, or call this whatever you want. Okay, and so this is interesting because then you can do some sort of interpolation from the original mesh to the output mesh only using integer indices. So you can bypass the FreeFM interpolator. So let me show you in practice what this means. So I will go back to the beginning of my script. And let's assume that on my mesh TH, I define a finite element space, okay, VH, okay. And let's say, for example, it's P2, okay. So this is a global finite element space. And now I define a global finite element function. So you probably know the syntax, the FreeFM syntax. First, you need to have the name of the finite element space, VH, and then the finite element function. Okay, so I will call this U. And then let's put some random values, cos x times sin 2 pi x, so 2 pi y. Okay, and so what we want to do basically is not only to trunk the mesh with respect to a given color, we also want to extract the degrees of freedom from U on my local mesh. Okay, so one trivial way to do this is to say, okay, so I have FreeFM at hand, I can just do interpolation. it's working magic, so let's do this. For example, FSpace VHBs, which will be defined on THBs, P2. And then I can do VHBs UBs equal U. Okay, so let's see what it gives. It should give you exactly the same result, in fact. And so where is the first? Okay, so I will plot color and I will plot TH and U. Okay, let's try this on Windows. It should work just as well. Freeframe square. Okay. Okay, so this is the mesh is quite large. Or the yes. Okay. Oh, qu'est-ce que j'ai fait? Okay, sorry. Here I put U, but in fact it's U bis. Tag. So let me kill this. Okay. Okay. So this is my. Oop. I need to put weight. Sorry. Weight equals to 1. Okay. So this is the this is the initial function. Okay, not very interesting. But basically, what we want to show you is different way to interpolate from one mesh to a smaller submesh. Okay, and so if you use the interpolator, it should work. And so we can check this. Okay, so this is one piece. It should. Okay, so this is one piece, another piece, okay, another piece, another piece, another piece. So everything is working nicely, okay? So this is in 2D, and this is a small mesh, and this is a Cartesian mesh. So in practice, if you deal with really weird meshes with really huge aspect ratios, it will give you the correct result, but it can give you the correct result in quite a long time because the interpolator needs to find the correct point to which element belongs, so on and so forth. And so with the new tool, you can actually compute exactly the same interpolation, but without using any kind of interpolation, by just using integer renumbering. Okay. And so to do that, you need first a renumbering of the triangles or the tetrahedrons in 3D, and then you will need a renumbering of the degrees of freedom. And so to compute this renumbering of degrees of freedom, you need to use another keyword, which is called restrict. Okay. And so, okay, so I don't remember by heart the API, but we will try. Let's call this rest or sub indices, and so the API I think is restrict, and so this time you need to put the finite element spaces. So on one side you have VH, on the other side you have VH bis, okay, and you need of course to supply the renumbering of the elements of the tetrahedrons and or triangles, so N2O. Okay, so let me just first check quickly if this runs. Okay, no, it does not run, so I think I flipped the order of the finite element space. Tack. Now it should run. Yes, perfect. Okay. And so what this means is that now you can actually extract the necessary degrees of freedom by just doing a purely algebraic operation. There is no need for the interpolator. So what you can do now is say UBIS bracket. So keep in mind, so this is quite advanced, but this is how freeform work. If you have a finite element function, you can either see it indeed as a finite element function, so UBIS, or you can see it as an array of scalar values, and you can use the bracket operation. Okay, and so now you can do something like UBIS bracket equal the original degrees of freedom, so u bracket bracket, and you just select the degrees of freedom that you've computed using the restrict keyword, okay? And tool. Okay, so let's check. So first I'm debugging on macOS and then I'm switching to, okay, so it's the other way around. So give me a sec. What is
I think it's sub ID X not N2, right?
Ah oui, thank you. Should be better, hopefully. Yes, thank you. Okay, so this should be debugged. And so now let's try this on Windows. But yeah. Tac. So this is again the original mesh. And so there we go. Okay, so again, nothing fancy, but a nice trick to keep in mind if you have some sort of multi-physics in your solver, or if you want to go from one domain to one subdomain, one small piece of your domain to the global domain, and so on. This is a tool that can be quite useful. And so, especially in 3D, sometimes the interpolator, when you have really nasty meshes, it can spend quite a lot of time in trying to get the good values. And so this is one way to do it purely algebraically. And so that can be nice. Okay, so I think that's basically the real basic tools that you need for when you look at the basics of domain decomposition and how we do parallel computing in FreeFM. Maybe I will just add a small comment. So let's just do a really stupid stuff. Okay, so I will comment this. Okay, and I will just say for the first subdomain or for the first color or whatever, I want to show you that it works also on the other way around. Okay, so you can of course do something like u equals u bis. So keep in mind that bis, u bis is the value on a given subdomain color, and so what this does is interpolate by continuity the value on the first color to the global domain. So just to show you what this gives, okay. Yes, that should work, hopefully. Okay. Am I missing? Ah, yes, I'm probably missing. Yes, thank you, David. Okay, so this is the global solution. I mean, this is the global function. This is the global function. Is the FreeFM interpolation always linear? In what sense do you mean? Is the cost of doing the interpolation linear? So here I'm mapping values from one big mesh to a smaller subset of the mesh, and so I'm looking just for the one-to-one correspondence between the degrees of freedom on the small mesh from the global mesh. Okay, you are supposed to get rigorously the same value. Now, of course, if you do interpolation between different kind of meshes or different kind of finite elements, so for example, if you interpolate a Lagrange P1 function into something like a P1 bubble finite element function, the interpolation will always be represented as a linear function on each element. I don't know if this answers your question, but basically if you interpolate a function, it's like computing the okay I, just. Computing, for example, this interpolation is nothing else than computing a matrix, which is something like interpolate of two finite element space. So I always get the order wrong, and computing afterwards U equals R, R times U bis. So the interpolation is always a linear mapping from one space to another. I hope it's answering your question. Okay, so back to this. So I will just put this at the bottom because, okay. And so yes, let's see what we get. We get this function. And so this is, as you can have, as you could have imagined, the interpolation by continuity on the complete domain. Okay. Oops. Okay. And so, actually, we will see in the comment in the terminal warning number. Okay. So you see a big bad message, which is not very encouraging, and that's basically because for all the triangles that lie outside of the small mesh, FreeFM does not find the corresponding triangles, and so it's triggering some sort of warning. Okay. And so, yes, I agree. I think interpolation. So of course the interpolation will depend on the finite element spaces, but I'm sorry, maybe I did not answer correctly to Matthias, but the way I understood his question was that we could always represent the interpolation from one F space to another as a linear mapping. But yeah, it's maybe the question is a little bit ambiguous, or I'm not fully understanding it. But sorry, but I guess I hope the example I gave you is good enough. Okay. Anyway, so if you are not interested by the prolongation by continuity, but for example, just want to put zero everywhere outside of your local submesh, you can actually do the exact transpose of what you had in the beginning, and so this time you can actually do so this is CNM equal prolongation by continuity. Okay, and so if you want to prolongate by zero, you can do exactly the dual of this line, and so the dual of this line is just to permute U bis and U. Okay. Okay. And so I don't want to store any previous values, so I will just force the value to be zero in the beginning. Okay. And so this will be a prolongation by zero. Okay. That should run, hopefully. Yes. Okay. So this is the initial function. This is the function restricted to a small part of the global domain. This is the prolongation. Oh, you don't see the legend. Okay. You don't. So prolongation by continuity and prolongation by zero. Okay. So yes, this is basically what's important when you think about parallel computing in FreeFM. First point is that at least in most of users' code, we always start with a mesh, which is then partitioned using either Scotch or Métis or Parmétis. And then we can have access to only local domains on each process on which we will perform the computations. Another important point is that sometimes, depending on what you are interested in, for example, quantities only inside the boundary layer or quantities only on the surface of a piece in your domain, you can bypass the use of the interpolator, which sometimes can give you either big warnings or results in a lot of time. You can also use the new to old and the restrict keyword to actually get the result in more efficient manner. Okay. So I think those are the most important tools when you think about sequential FreeFM. And so now the idea is to transpose those tools into a true parallel example, let's say. Okay. Of course, if you have questions or whatever, please feel free to ask us. And so now we will start with a new file because it will be easier that way. Okay. And so I will call this sq_mpi.zip. So again, we want to go from start to finish. So we don't want to give you an example with a really fancy domain and something really impossible to understand. So again, I will start with a square, but of course you can adapt this to any kind of mesh you are interested in, let's say. Okay, so I will start again with a square, really simple, nothing too fancy for the beginning. So there are different tools that you can use inside FreeFM to help you perform the domain decomposition and have FreeFM handle all the exchange between subdomains and so on for you. So the two tools that you can use are basically FFDDM, and there is so you can do include FFDDM. Okay, so this is one way to have FreeFM perform for you the domain decomposition. There is another small macro which is called the macro DDM. So the name is a little bit less fancy, let's say. Okay, and so I will mostly focus here on what you can do with macro DDM. But again, you should get a pretty good idea of what you can do with the parallel capabilities of FreeFM. Okay. So once you load this small macro, you have access to a lot of other macros actually that can be used to generate domain decomposition, assemble matrices, so on and so forth. Okay. So the first step that we want to do is to actually do exactly what was done in sequential, but this time in parallel. Okay. So if you go back to what we wrote in the beginning, okay. We had here a number of color 20, and so now the ID will be to use the number of MPI processes that you use to launch your program. Okay. And so now I remind myself that, of course, maybe not all of you are familiar with MPI, and so I will actually first do a quick introduction to MPI. MPI. So again, it's the message passing interface, and it can be used to have multiple processes interact with each other. And so, for example, when you use FreeFM++ MPI, you have access to a new variable, a lot of new variables actually, such as, for example, the MPI rank and MPI size. Okay, so this will be a quick hello world to MPI. Okay. What is the rank? The rank is basically a unique identifier that lets each process identify itself. So I am rank 0, I am rank 1, I am rank 2, so on and so forth. And there are as many ranks as the size of the global communicator. So we talk about communicator in MPI. The communicator is basically the set of processes which are used to perform the computations. Okay, so if you use this simple script, for example, you can do. So first, let's try FreeFM++. You will see a nice error message. The identifier MPI rank does not exist. Okay, so this is what you get from not using FreeFM++ MPI. Okay, So the small modification that you have is just to put MPI here, and this should work. Okay. So now I want to I want FreeFM to be slightly less verbose, so I can use the dash NS. And so even less verbose, I will just put the verbosity to zero. Okay, and so you see that so we are doing MPI is mostly implemented in C, and so we are numbering using C style indices, and so it starts from zero and goes up to MPI size minus one. So here we have only a single process, so we just get zero slash one. Of course, now we will check with ffmpi run. ffmpi run minus n2 sqmpi, and I think by default ffmpi run puts the verbosity to zero, so let's just check that. Nope, so I will do that then. There we go. So now we are using FreeFM++ MPI on two process, and so you can see that both process, of course, they are not talking to each other, but you can see that it's there, and so you will be able to harvest them for the actual part, the actual FreeFM computation. Okay, and so we can just do whatever, as many processes as you want. Of course, right now we are just eating our laptop, so it's not really interesting. But just to show you, it can of course be done as well in FreeFM in Windows. So in Windows, I forgot to say, but you need to install the .exe, and if you want to do actual parallel computing, you also need to install MSMPI. So maybe so I'm not really familiar with MSMPI. Okay, so you type MSMPI and you can download Microsoft MPI. So it's quite straightforward. Anyway, let's check on Windows, FreeFM++ MPI. What was the name? SQ underscore MPI.edp. Okay, so I have only a single process, so no big deal. And then I go to program files, Microsoft MPI, bin, MPI exec, MPI exec, minus N4, for example, FreeFM++, MPI, sqmpi.edp. Oops, forgot the verbosity. Okay, so everything is working. You can now start using the message passing interface. Okay, so I will not go into the details of the message passing interface, but the idea is that you can have processes talk to each other. For example, you can call routines such as isend or ireceive. So maybe I will just quickly do that. So isend, I think you can send a real. So I will call this send. Real receive. So let's say send equal MPI rank. Okay. So send, of course, will have different values if you are on process zero, or if you are on process one, or if you are on process two, so on and so forth. Okay. And so let's say that if I'm process Z three, so if MPI rank equal three, I want to isend the value of send to process zero. So you can do processor zero. Okay, and so of course, if you are then process zero, you want to receive from process three. So else, receive from processor three. Okay, tac, tac, tac. And so now let's see. So let's say that for all process, I want to initialize this to a stupid value such as minus 11. Okay. And so now I just want to say MPI rank value is, and so I want to say receive. Okay. Okay. So let's check on Windows, for example. It should work. No reason. Okay. Of course, you can have syntax error. So that's my bad. And I think it's because I switched. The first you need to put processor and then the variable name, tac. Tac. Let's permute each other. Okay. Okay. Maybe better. Hopefully better. Okay. Now it looks like I have a deadlock.
This is with four cores. You might need to execute with two.
De quoi?
Ah, ah tu...
ouais, peut-être.
I thought it was with two processes. My bad.
Ah, of course. Okay, so this is one example of a stupid deadlock. Else if MPI rank equals zero. Okay, better. So of course, everything is crumbled together. So that's one issue with parallel computing. You have your processes that are running in an order that is not known a priori. And so on the output, you may get somehow difficult to decipher message. So maybe actually I will try back on the Windows because everything is slower there. So, okay. And so indeed, you can see that you've got the garbage value minus 11 on all process, but on process zero, where we have successively received the value from process three. Okay. So what I'm showing here is miles away from FreeFM, but it's actually really useful because if you want to learn about parallel computing, one of the most dominant paradigms is MPI. And so if you ever cross a fully low-level implementation that is using MPI, so if you look at some Fortran or C++ code that uses MPI, you will see that it's a real pain because you have all sorts of boilerplate code like MPI initialize, MPI finalize, wait, so on and so forth. And so if you want to learn more about parallel computing, not necessarily parallel finite elements, but parallel computing, FreeFM is actually a wonderful tool to help you understand what is a deadlock, what is a broadcast, what is a reduction, so on and so forth. Okay. So this was just a small parenthesis with respect to FreeFM plus MPI. Okay, so now we go back to business, and so I will just put the quick introduction to parallel to MPI at the beginning, and then I will just jump back to the parallel finite element stuff. So as I told you, there are different tools to define efficient preconditioners or parallel solvers. I will focus mostly on one, which use the macro ddm.edp file. And so when you load this file, you have access to a bunch of other macros. And so for example, one macro that you have access to is create, I don't even remember. So I'm cheating a little bit. Macro mesh. Do not look at my screen. Build demesh. Yes. Okay. So it's called build demesh. Okay. So what is this weird name? Well, this weird name is basically if you expand the D stands for distributed, and the idea is that we take for you the sequential mesh TH. Okay. So this is sequential, let's say sequential global mesh, okay? And the idea is that we break it apart in multiple subdomains that will be each dispatched among the processes you have on your machine, or at least on the processes you are using FreeFM plus MPI, okay? What I mean by that is that, for example, after this call, if I do something like cout MPI rank th.nt, the number of triangles or the number of tetrahedron. So I will comment this actually because there will be a lot of output, unnecessary output. Okay. If I just cout the number of triangles, we will see that the original mesh will be decomposed into multiple smaller subdomains. Okay. So let's try that on Windows. For now, everything is simple, so I can just use Windows and I don't have to wait a lot of time. Okay, so So our original domain is decomposed in four subdomains, and you can see that the subdomains are different ones from each other, and they are basically spread on the four processes that I've been using to launch my computation. Okay, so of course I can use a single process if I want. It's not really useful. It's just the same as doing freeform, standard freeform. But just to show you that everything works from one to a lot of processes. Okay, so one, then I can do two, so on and so forth. Okay, so if you look closely at the numbers, you can actually see that when you go from one to two, you have a little bit more than half of the original number of elements. Okay, if you look at three, you can see that if you sum those three variables, it's slightly different than 800. And you can actually see that the higher the number of subdomains, the higher the difference between 800 and the sum of local number of triangles. Okay, and so I will explain it to you now. The idea is that when you do the domain decomposition in freeform and also in all finite element packages, most finite element packages, we need to add some information, and so we have subdomains with a little bit of overlap, what we call overlap, and that means that we expand a little bit the subdomains along the skeleton that we get between the subdomains actually. So I will show you an example. Once you do build dmesh, you can call, if I'm not mistaken, plot dmesh, th, cmm, decomposition. I'm not sure it will work, but anyway, we're here to try. Okay, of course I need to put with graphics. Okay, and so here you can see that there is some overlap. So you can see the black curves, okay, which represent the subdomain decomposition. And so you can see, for example, you can see that, for example, between the red and the blue subdomain, you have an overlapping region between both subdomains, okay? So the same applies to all subdomain. And so these are what is usually called in the freeform, in the finite element literature, ghost elements or overlapping elements. Okay, and so this is useful to compute quantities easily in a distributed matter. So I won't go into the theory of parallel matrix assembly and so on. But this is something that you have to keep in mind. Once we do the domain decomposition, we take the Scotch or the Métis partitioning, but we have also the need for some from few ghost elements. Okay, so we have effectively what we call an overlapping domain decomposition. Okay, so FFGrid is apparently broken on Windows, so that's no big deal. But I can switch from 3D to 2D, and so of course. We take care, so you can see in the original code that you don't need to load yourself Scotch, you don't need to load yourself Métis. Everything is carried out for you, and we generate all the needed data automatically for you. Okay, so this works for an arbitrary number of processes. So for example, it works in sequential. Okay, so you have a single subdomain, a single process, so nothing fancy. But it works also, let's say, for four subdomains. Okay, so this is the domain decomposition with the overlapping region that you can see here between the blue lines. Okay. Okay. And if you want to make your computer heat up, you can even go higher. Wow, I'm surprised by how efficient it is even on Windows, actually. So, of course, what is interesting actually here is that, so maybe Task Manager, okay. Here you can see, so this is a virtual machine, and I have only two processes, but nothing stops you from actually launching your problem on more than two processes. Okay, so this is something that you have to keep in mind. It may be interesting, for example, to debug or to make sure that your software, your solver is robust, to launch this on a slightly more process than you have actually on your machine. Okay. Okay. So this is how easy it is to switch from the sequential script that we started with, where there are explicit calls to Scotch or Métis. So to switch from this sequential script to a parallel version. And so now the idea is to do parallel computing with this domain decomposition. Okay. Tac. So, I don't see any questions. So I will start. I will continue on something rather simple. And just as for this morning, I will write the code to solve, for example, the Poisson equation, and then maybe we will switch to 3D, and then we will see what you'd like to see next. Okay. So Poisson equation. Again, we want to make sure for you that it's rather easy to switch from a sequential script to a parallel script, because again, if you have a complete solver that you spend countless hours developing, we don't want the MPI layer to be stopping you from going parallel. Okay, it's really important for us to make sure that it's as easy as possible to transition from a sequential script to a parallel script. Okay, and so if there are some technical difficulties that you think should be lifted, please let us know. So these are some technical difficulties, but we hope they are lightweight enough for you to not be too troublesome, let's say. Okay. So next we will switch to Poisson equation. Okay. So for Poisson equation, just as for this morning, we have our mesh, and so we can define let's define a finite element space, VH. TH, so okay, let's say that we have a function pk, let's say we want to do p2, okay, p2, pk, okay, so we have the definition of our finite element space, and so you are in the expert tutorial, so I think you know about the varf keyword for defining a weak formulation, and so you can do v Poisson or v Laplace or whatever. And so V Poisson UV equal int 2D. So we are doing a two-dimensional integration on the complete domain, but of course here it will be on the complete subdomain. Okay, so we have done the domain decomposition here. So everything afterward will be defined locally. Careful, TH is now local. H DXU. So I'm not a big fan of macros, but you can write this in more compact form, I guess. DYU times DYV. Okay, so this is the bilinear form, just as this morning, plus into the linear form. Let's say we have a constant source term, F equal 1, and then you have the Dirichlet boundary condition, and so we will do 4 on 4 because this morning it was on 1, and let's assume that we do something non-homogeneous. Okay, so this is the weak form, and again there are multiple ways to solve systems in parallel in freeform. I will try to focus on the one which is the less intrusive, let's say, and so which hopefully is easier to try on, but of course you are free to try different approaches, and so the in my opinion the one which is the less intrusive is using PETSI, And so if you want to start using Petsy, of course you need to load Petsy because it's not there by default, just as you need to load MUMS, for example, if you want to do MUMS instead of Petsy. Okay. So you can load Petsy, great. And so as I told you this morning, Petsy has a type which is called mat. Okay. So actually, as I said this morning, most of the new developments are user-driven in the sense that let's have a quick look. For example, let's go here, and if you go and type mat Petsy, okay, you can go then into the Petsy manual, and you'll see basically that there are tons and tons and tons and tons of functions. Okay. And so there is only a tiny fraction of those functions interfaced inside Petsy, inside FreeFM, sorry. And so if you are interested in stuff that is available in Petsy, but that is not available in FreeFM through the Petsy plugin, please let us know, and we will try to interface the proper wrapper, okay? So if you use other tools like Phoenix or FireDrake, for example, they also use Petsy as a linear algebra backend, but they use also Petsy for Py, so the Python wrapper to Petsy, and so everything is by default interfaced. In FreeFM domain-specific language, it's a little bit tricky in the sense that we have to make the connections ourselves, but it's no big deal. Please let us know. Okay. So once you load Petsy, you can define a Petsy matrix. So Petsy matrices are called mat. And so I will just say, okay, I have a mat A, okay? And so one difficulty of distributed finite elements is that you need to be able to know how your subdomains or your multiple processes communicate one with another, okay? And so this is, of course, taken care by the macro ddm.edp for you. And so this is the small routine that I showed this morning, which is called create mat. Okay. So then you need to put the mesh, of course, the name of the matrix, and the kind of finite element space it will be stored inside the distributed matrix. Okay. PK. So what this small call does is basically say to FreeFM to interact with Petsy to know how to distribute a parallel matrix. Okay. And so then it's quite straightforward. You can simply do in your parallel matrix, I want to assemble my variational formulation, V poisson, VH. Okay. So this does parallel finite element numbering, let's say, and so this is the parallel finite element assembly. Okay, tac, and so this is the parallel Petsy matrix. Okay. So I will try to run this code just to make sure it's working fine. So let's try first on Windows, and then I will show you some slight small stuff on macOS. So okay, it runs to completion. So I'm guessing it's okay. Okay. So if you want to get some insight into the structure of the matrix, for example, you can use the routine object view, for example, A. And so there are many, many different formats. So for example, you can do format equal, I think you can do info, okay? So let's check that. Yes. So info tells you the dimension of your problem, the number of non-zeros. Okay, if you are a MATLAB guy and you want to do some MATLAB post-processing, you can export to MATLAB. So I think this is quite, oh no, this is not too slow. Well, yeah, no, this is slow. But anyway, you get the parallel. Yes, this is definitely slow. I think there is more than 1,000 unknowns. Okay, so you've got the full script that you can then input inside the MATLAB. Okay, so I will just tell ffgrid loop exit. Okay, you can also directly, I think you can directly put that on the disk, name equal a.m. Let's check. Okay. And of course, I don't know how to open a file in the command prompt. okay. Oops. Sorry. Where is it? Okay. So I'm sharing my disk between my Windows virtual machine and my macOS. So it's in ffduck. I think it's here. A.m. Yes, perfect. Okay, so you've got your MATLAB script, your MATLAB matrix, sorry. And you can do all sorts of fancy stuff. For example, you can. So let's forget about this, and you can have the matrix be drawn on screen. Mat view draw pose minus one. I think this should work. Of course, my matrix is okay. There you go. So this is my matrix. Oh, give me a sec. Draw pose. Okay, so I'm sorry, I don't remember by heart how to specify the size of the output window. So you'll have to look really closely to your monitor. Okay, so I will forget about this and just show you in tiny. I hope that the zoom compression algorithm does not mess up the output. I'm sorry about this, but basically you can see that you have a mostly triangular diagonal matrix, at least block diagonal, and then you have some coefficients on the x of diagonal blocks, which are basically the interaction between subdomains. Okay. So if you run this, for example, with one process, you'll see a fully nicely structured problem because there are no interactions between subdomains. Okay, and so then when you switch to parallel assembly, you'll have some off-diagonal blocks which represent the interaction between one subdomain and the other. Okay. So just one quick remark: if you do this with the Petsy compiled by FreeFM for you, we automatically deactivate the output, the visual output. So you cannot do MatViewDraw. And just to make sure that I'm not a fool, I will just run this. And so hopefully, if you do MatViewDraw. Here we will have a nice error warning by Petsy saying that you need to compile with something machine. Yeah. Oh, it works on Windows. That's okay. Well, I will not complain, I guess. Let me try in parallel. Maybe it's in parallel that is done. Oh yes. What does it tell us? Cannot. Okay, so apparently it works on Windows, but only with one process. Just a small message, if you are using Petsy or SlepC, the error messages are usually much more meaningful than in FreeFM. So in FreeFM, sometimes you will have weird error or warning, like previously, warning wrong search direction or whatever. A search method. Well, if you don't know what this means, well, good luck. But usually in Petsy and SlepC, usually the error message are slightly more decipherable. So in this case, I don't know what is a singleton for type Win32, but you get the idea. Hopefully, it's a little bit easier to decipher those kind of error messages. A question regarding the overlap nodes on the ghost elements. Do they have the same? Ah, okay. What happens to the if we go from the local mesh to the global mesh with? Okay. So this is actually a really interesting question because this is what's needed. For example, if you do parallel, if you do mesh adaptation. Can we answer this right now? Yes, I guess we have all the tools needed. So in the chat there is a question about overlapped unknowns. So unknowns that are inside ghost elements, to put it differently. And so indeed, there is nothing that guarantees that you have the same values everywhere. So I will actually make an example. For this, let's start with something really simple, which is let's define a finite element function u, okay, which is known analytically, okay. So for example, x plus cos y. Okay. So first thing that you have to remember, if you do plot u, so do I have some? I'm plotting the D mesh. Okay, let's skip that for the moment. Okay, so plot U should, it will work. So let's do that again on the Windows machine. Just as Frederic was expected that everything was running smoothly during the presentation, I'm amazed that everything is going smoothly on Windows as well. So that's nice. Not too many technical issues today. Let's start with one process. Okay, so this is your function. Okay, and so now if you do two processes, you have to keep in mind that, of course, if you are running this on Windows, on Linux or macOS, you can skip all this and just put ffmpi run, okay, or no, mpi run. Or you can remove the FreeFM++ MPI and just put FFMPI run. Okay. So if you use two processes, here you see only part of the mesh. Okay. So that's because only rank 0 can plot on the screen. Okay. And so inside the macro DDM, we have small utility, a small routine which can be used to supersede plot. And so it's plot D. So you need this time to use the mesh you are using, and you need to have something like a phi equal 1. Okay. So let's relaunch this part, this example. Okay. So now I have the complete mesh. Okay. So why am I talking about this? I'm talking about this because give me a sec. If I have, instead of this analytical function, something which is not continuous among subdomains, so for example MPI rank, okay, you will clearly see, I mean you should see, maybe not on my screen but maybe on yours, you should see that you have something which is not at all contiguous, and more importantly the values are not the same across subdomains. Okay, so this is something to be careful to keep in mind, you need to make sure that the values is the same across subdomains, and of course I will now show you how to ensure that you have a proper continuous solution, but anyway I will just highlight this once again with, for example, for process. Okay, and so here you can see that there are clear values on the overlapping region where the ghost element the ghost degrees of freedom do not share the same value. Okay, and so if you want to make sure that the solution is consistent across the complete domain, you have to use a small mathematical tool which is called the partition of unity. And so the partition of unity can be, so it's a definition of a set of matrices that are defined on each subdomain that ensures that whatever you use as an input function, as an output, if you use the partition of unity to process your input vector, you'll get something consistent among the subdomains. Okay? And so if you want to invoke this small post-processing step, sorry, you need to, so I will replace the fill by weight. Okay? So the API, I think it's exchange. So exchange as exchange between subdomains. Then you need to use the finite element space, the distributed finite element space. So in this case, it's represented by the parallel matrix A, A. And then you need to put the input vector. Okay. So this is algebraic. So you need to put bracket, bracket. And you need to say that you want to have the values being exchanged between subdomain and scaled by the partition of unity. So you need to put scale, I think. I will check. Okay, does this run? Okay, API seems to be okay. So, okay. So this is the non-consistent function with different values on the overlapping region for the ghost elements. And this is the conforming function with the proper values among subdomains. So now you have a unique function which is uniquely defined on all elements overlapping or not overlapping. Okay. So I think this answers the first part of your question. Let me know if you don't think this is the case. Oh, okay. One other thing is that, of course, the partition of unity, if you want to just do, because of the definition of the partition of unity, you can apply it 1,000 times and you will still get the same consistent result. So you can do up. Okay. Once the results are consistent among subdomains, it stays the same. Tac tac. Okay. So if I just do a stupid loop, just to show that the solution is consistent. Okay. I do this. Okay. And so I get exactly the same result. Okay. So the second part of the question, it's a little bit, it's slightly more tricky, but I will try to answer this right now. So the restrict function that we had in sequential is indeed a fantastic tool for constructing a global solution from local solutions. But it's a little bit more tricky to use in parallel because once we have used the build dmesh function, okay, the mesh th is purely local, okay. So you don't have access. You lose all the connectivity with respect to the original global mesh, okay. So in the macro ddm.tdp, we have a way to deal with this by before calling the build dmesh, defining a small macro, okay, which is called, if I memory serves me well, thn2o, okay, n2o. And so it basically tells to the build dmesh macro that you want to keep the connectivity between the local subdomains and the global mesh, the global initial mesh, okay. And so you can feed that. And of course, you want to store this inside the N2O. So this is a random value. This is whatever you want. My N2O, for example. Okay, my N2O. Okay. And so the way. So this. I'm not 100% satisfied by the API, but this is how it is right now. Of course, you need to define this macro. By using the same prefix as the variable name you use inside the build dmesh. So for example, if you do something like, so I will just comment this, but if you do build dmesh of th 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, you need to have th 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. Same prefix as in build dmesh. Ok. Do you follow me, Mojtaba, or sorry if I might mispronounce your name, but since you asked the question, I want to make sure that I'm your. Yeah, okay, that's okay, good. So this will tell, this tells, oh, sorry, I see that I have something wrong in my Vim number coloring. Okay. This should be in blue, but that's no big deal. This tells build image to keep the local to global local. Keep the local to global correspondence. Maybe there is a typo. Correspondence. No. Yes. Okay. Okay. And so now you can use this my N2O, just as before in the sequential case, okay? By first creating a backup of your original mesh, backup th equal th, okay. And so you can use the restrict with my n2o and backup th. So in practice, what does it look like? This is mostly garbage. So this is important. The for loop is well. Okay, I will keep this for now. The ingredients that we need to focus on is backup th and my n2o. So backup th and my n2o. Okay. So backup th, this is the global mesh that we backed up before doing any sort of domain decomposition or domain distribution. So first we need to define FSpace on this one, VH global, for example, backup th. And of course, we need to use the same finite element space, so pk. Okay. And then, just as in sequential, in the previous script, you can define you can use the restrict command. So int. So what was the name in sequential? I had some stupid name, I guess, that I will reuse. Subidx, perfect. Subidx equal restrict. And so I have to be careful. In this script, vhbis was the local mesh. So here it's called VH, and VH previously was the global mesh. So now it's called VH global PK. Okay. So first, let's make sure that it's running fine. Always start in sequential. N2O, okay, does not exist. So it does not work. Nice. N2O, okay, of course. If I change variable here but not there, it will not work. N2O. Okay, alors, so restrict int. What was the issue? Ah, of course. No, of course not. Ah, of course. Of course. You don't need to specify PK because FreeFM knows that VH and VH globals are PK finite PK FSpace. I put the wrong variable here. It's not PK, it's my N2O. Okay, should be better. Let's try. Okay. Runs to completion on one proc. Let's try two process. And runs to completion as well. Perfect. Okay. So now, what we have construct is the lists of or the arrays of integers that map a global finite element function to a local finite element function. Okay. And so, just to convince you that I'm not saying something stupid, I will show this in practice by defining a local function vhloc. Okay. And then saying loc equal x cos cos x fois cos y cos 2py 2py, okay? And then I will define a global. And so using exactly the same numbering as previously, I will do unit. So this was the local to global, the global. So this is the global, the local to global. Sorry. So glob sub edX equals loc. Okay. And so for now, I will only do this in one process. So plot loc weight equal one and plot glob weight equal one. Okay. So for people who are not 100% following, I will just quickly recap what we've done thus far. So we started by using a global mesh TH, which is square. Okay. We backed up this initial mesh because we wanted to do some post-processing like mesh adaptation or whatever. Then we used a small macro that can be loaded to do all the domain decomposition for us. We told this tool that we actually want to do some kind of post-processing, and so that we want to keep the global to local numbering using the new to old routine that I previously described. Okay. Then I did the actual domain decomposition using build dmesh. So after that, TH is a purely local mesh. And then I did some standard freeform. So I defined my finite element space. I defined my Poisson varref. I loaded Petsy because I want to define a Petsy matrix. And I assembled my my global matrix using the standard freeform variational formulation. Okay. So this is not important now. We have skipped. We are on the next part. Okay. And so now the idea is to show how to do the backup from the local to the global mesh, and of course without using any sort of interpolation, because interpolation, especially in parallel, can be somehow costly. Okay. And so here I'm only working on process zero because only on process number zero, because plot only works there. Because plot only works there. Zoom group chat, I can see. Okay. Okay. So now let's go back to the Windows VM. Okay. So this, I don't even remember what this is. Okay, so this is the local solution, and this is the local solution extended, interpolated by zero everywhere outside. Okay, so I think this does exactly what you wanted, at least on process zero. Okay, and so now we will actually see that it can be a little bit more tricky when we use multiple processes. And the reason behind this is that now we have a global function, okay? And so what you can do is again use the really nice tool, the nice tools, MPI tools defined by Freeform MPI, and you can do a summation of all the local components interpolated by zero on the global mesh. And so this is done using a routine which is called AllReduce, or even Reduce, but we will do AllReduce. And so the idea now is to sum up everything together. So this will be a global function, and I will call this sum. And so we want to sum up everything. And so this is done at the algebraic level, not at the finite element kernel level. And so we need to use the bracket bracket operator. And we put this inside the sum variable. Okay. Now, what's next? You need to put for the reduction the communicator which is used for the reduction. So in this case, we use the global communicator. So the global communicator is called MPI comworld. And the kind of reduction that we do is a summation. So we do a summation MPI sum. So again, if you know a little bit about FreeFM, about MPI, well, you probably know that when you need to do a reduction with MPI, you have all sorts of variables like the data type, the size of your arrays, the communicator, so on and so forth. And so once again, it's a nice proof that FreeFM++ MPI is a nice way to learn about MPI without the agonizing pain of having a lot of MPI boilerplate code. Okay. Anyway, this was just a parenthesis. Now we go back to actual computations and we plot the sum. Okay. So I will put some comments because it will start to get understandable. So this is the local function on process 0. This is the local function interpolated or prolongated or whatever you want, interpolated by zero, local function from proc zero interpolated by zero on the global domain. And this is the reduced local function. Okay, and so now we should see something which is not correct. Okay, MPI all reduce. Okay, I think there is a capital R in the all reduce. Yes, okay, so local function. So far, so good. And oh, what is this? Well, you see basically exactly as before. On the overlapping subdomains, on the overlapping region, on the ghost elements, we have summed up multiple times the original local function. Okay? And so once again, we have to resort to the use of the partition of unity, which is a real life saver in domain decomposition and in parallel finite elements. And so you can use the partition of unity to scale the function so that it will be consistent when you do the summation among MPI process. So this MPI all reduce here, problem because of ghost elements, okay? Need to use partition of unity, okay? And so how do you use the partition of unity? Well, you need to put this again. Okay, so I will just write this down. So the partition of unity associated to a given finite element space or a mat, a parallel matrix, is you can access it using the dot D operator, because the partition of unity is usually a diagonal matrix. And so you can do what is the name of my matrix? It's A. So you can do A dot D. Oops, A dot D. Okay. And so now the idea is to scale the vector before doing the summation. Okay, so how to do that? I just copy paste all the previous script. Okay, and so first I will reset my glob vector to zero. Okay, and so before putting lock inside glob, I need to scale lock by the partition of unity. Okay. It may be tough to follow, so please, if I need to repeat something, let me know. But what you can do is, so you need to do entry-wise multiplication. So I don't remember if it's this or dots. Okay, I will try both. And now we should get the correct value. Let's check. So everything is working on Windows, so let's stay on Windows, I guess. Okay, so this was the wrong call without the partition of unity, and this is the correct call with the partition of unity. Okay. So I think it answers your both of your questions. I will actually show another way to do this. You're welcome. So I will show you another special trick. It's the expert tutorial, so we are here to learn about nice techniques and so on. So at the beginning, you mentioned ghost elements. Okay. So maybe I will actually show you my show part of my tutorial here because I need to. So it's at the. Okay, I'm sorry for your eyes, but it may be easier to explain if I have a picture in front of me. Too many pages. Okay, so thus far we have been using Petsy for distributing our workload. And so what you have to keep in mind is that Petsy, even though they are ghost unknowns, the unknowns are associated to one and only one process, okay? So if you think of a matrix, just as the H matrices presented by Pierre-Henri this morning, Petsy follows a row-wise distribution, okay? And so even if you look at how the domain decomposition is performed, you have to keep in mind that all the unknowns inside the Petsy matrix are owned by a single process, okay? And so there is a correspondence, let's say, between the way Petsy numbers its unknowns and the way FreeFM numbers its unknowns on all subdomains, okay? And so you can actually use that to, let's say, trick FreeFM. And so, in fact, this operation can be done much easier by using the Petsy partition, the Petsy numbering, because in Petsy, you have the unknowns are stored on, are owned, let's say, by a single process. Okay, so I will just show you quickly how to do this. There is a routine that can be used to go from FreeFM to Petsy numbering and vice versa. Okay, so let's say real int loc Petsy. This will be a local vector, but in Petsy numbering. And so you can do change numbering of your input vector. So loc. So you need to put the math, of course. Loc Petsy. Okay, and so I will show you what this gives. So I will comment everything from now because we don't need this. Okay, and so what this does is so I will just put So basically, what I will do is go from FreeFM to Petsy numbering, and then immediately go back from Petsy to FreeFM numbering. And so this can be done using the keyword inverse equal true. Okay. And so now plot D. Plot D lock. We should see something interesting in the sense that it's tough to see. I will shift everything from the origin. I will put 2 plus. Okay. Okay. So what we see basically is that for the unknowns that are on the overlap, but that are not owned by the process, and so they are owned by another process, we set the value to 0, okay? And so this is important now because you can just do the summation just as before, but you know that you've put to 0 the overlapping degrees that are not owned by the local process, and so you are not, there is no problem of partition of unity and redundant unknowns from the ghost elements. So I will just show you now. It's actually much easier. You can just do as before the reduction, and this will work out of the box. Tack, glob, up, and then plot sum. And so here, problem, no problem, because ghost, je vois pas, because of, no problem, because ghost elements, put to zero by change numbering if not locally owned. And then you do a plot sum reduced local function without duplicated values. It should give the correct value. And again, let's stick to Windows since everything is working nicely. There we go. Okay, so we get the correct value. So that's two way. It really depends on your taste. Two ways to actually recompute a global solution from local solution without having to use the interpolator. And so this is especially useful if you look at a complex 3D mesh with bad aspect ratio. Sometimes the interpolator can have some troubles. And so I always recommend users who need the global solution to use this small N2O or new to old array. Okay. Of course, it should still work in sequential, I think. Oh, maybe change numbering is not properly. No, okay, it works. And of course, you can try up. 8. Okay, so here we put 2, 0, and so when we sum, no duplicated unknowns, no duplicated values, so everything is correct. No need for the partition of unity here. And just making sure that it works as well if you are using a Mac OS or something like that, mpi.edp-v0 with graphics. C'est bon. Alors, hop, ouh, c'est lent, dis donc. It's slow. Slower on macOS than on Windows. Who would have thought? Okay. Okay. So it's been 2 hours and we've still not solved a single linear system. So I apologize. But now we will get to the bottom of the Poisson equation, hopefully. So for now we've been using this chain numbering is one of the most mysterious functions. Yes, it's a little bit mysterious, I agree. There are some explanations, maybe, I'm not even sure. Yeah, there are some explanation, some more explanation in the tutorial. It takes a lot of time to document everything perfectly. I do agree, but I at least if it's more clear for you now, it's nice. So now we've been using a really stupid analytical function, but the idea of course is to use, for example, something like a metric produced by MSHMet and then do some kind of mesh adaptation. And so to do that, I will just go back to where we were before the nice question. I spent quite some time explaining and answering this question, but these are really fundamental tools. If you need to get the global solution some way. Okay, maybe just a small comment. If you just want to do this, to do some sort of post-processing, or if you want to get some clear, pretty pictures, let's say, there is another way to do this through ParaView. Okay, and so what is nice is that once you load the Petsy plugin, we take care automatically for you of all the post-processing with respect to ParaView. So let me show you a quick example. For example, let's say that you want to print your pretty function, and so you can use the same API as the IOVTK plugin. So same API as IOVTK. But no need to load. But no need to load automatically. Done by load Petsy. Okay. And so if you know a little bit about the SaveVTK format, so the SaveVTK API, basically what you need to do is SaveVTK, the name of your mesh, so in this case TH, the name of your I think you need to put first the domain, the output name. So I will say pretty.vtu. Please do not use VTK format anymore. Like this is not okay. This is deprecated. So deprecated. Okay. So please use .vtu. It's basically the same for you, but for us, it's better because we don't have to answer to your question why there is a bug and why don't I see my geometry. It's because VTK format is deprecated, so we don't maintain the interface anymore inside the plugin. So always use .vtu, okay? And so then you need to put lock, and then there is some mysterious call ffOrder, which tells to the IOVTK plugin that you are plotting linear or constant by mesh element function. So in the case of linear, it's order, ffOrder. And so then ffOrder is just an array of size 1 with a value of 1. And if you want to put a p0 function, so it's 1 for p1 or higher and 0 for p0. Okay? So this will save. Okay, so let me try this. Okay, 8. My Windows VM is on fire, so okay. And so just to show you, maybe you expect to have a pretty.vtu file, but in practice, you will not have this file. You will have a pretty underscore number of process on which you used FreeFM++ MPI .pvd. And the .pvd format is the way ParaView handles parallel IO, parallel input-output. So you can open this file .pvd with ParaView. Okay. Okay, so I will just make sure that my Windows fit inside the Zoom. Okay. And so you get your solution and you get your domain decomposition. And so you get your nice solution. So if you, so the restrict, chain numbering, partition of unity stuff, if you need to use that just for visualization purposes, drop it. You can directly save to VTK and we take care of everything for you. You can see the domain decomposition. You can see, well, this is just ParaView, but in parallel. Okay. And of course, we can also help you make nice movies. So if you go back to your script, and you say, okay, let's say that let's imagine that I have another function. So this time I will use something like Express Y. Okay, you can just say save VTK pretty.vtu, and then you say append equal to true, and this will generate automatically for you a nice movie. So let's go back to Windows. Tag. Okay. And so this time it will generate a movie. So if you have a movie, of course you will have more files. You have one file per time step and per subdomain. And again, you can just open your file. Okay, so I will start from scratch. Open Pretty 1. Okay, and we have automatically for you a nice movie. So scalar 1, and then you can see that you can go up to 1 tack. Okay, so of course here the movie is not very interesting, but you get the idea. If you use Petsy inside a time stepping scheme, you will get something much much nicer. Okay, and so keep in mind VTU is basically the sequential format, and PVD means that you have a parallel file. And of course, if you run the same thing but with 4 processes, you'll get something which is prefixed by 4. And so now we go here and you have the for.pd. And so this time the decomposition will be on for subdomain, of course. So I'm seeing the question. I will just answer afterward. Okay. Tac, VTK composite, you have your four blocks and everything is nice. Okay. Is there also a way to remove the visible? Okay. So this is kind of a tricky question. In 2D, I think there is one. And so you can do a threshold label. So this is not expert. This is expert plus plus question. But anyway, I will try to answer. There you go. So why am I saying it's expert plus plus? It's because you are really inside the guts of how we do the domain decomposition. So in practice, when you do domain decomposition, it's true that you can see that. There are those lines which basically correspond to each subdomain, okay? And so in FreeFM, we assign to those lines the label, a random label, I mean, not so random, a value, but which is an internal value. So in practice, we assume that you don't need that. If you need that, for example, for doing some sort of advanced boundary condition between subdomains, of course you can access it, but there are also some other tools, for example in FFDDM it's easier to play with those kind of parameters. But anyway, inside ParaView here, if you do domain decomposition with macro ddn.idp, you need to use a threshold on the labels, and so you need to basically remove the label -1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, so there are 6 ones. Okay, if you do 6 ones, there is nothing that is changing, but if you just do tac, well, just put 0. It was working before, I don't see why it would not work now. Sorry, I'm not showing the correct thing. Okay. So just making sure that I was not saying anything stupid. The default, the internal label is this stupid value. So here there are the lines. Maybe you're not seeing this properly. How can I zoom? Yeah, I can zoom, I think. Okay. And so as soon as I put a value which is slightly below here, there you go. Okay. So I hope it answers your question. Sadly, in 3D, it's a little bit more tricky. But you can get in touch with me and I will try to, depending on the finite element space you want to output, the threshold, the machinery you need to do in ParaView is not the same. So I'm a little bit sorry about that. But in my defense, it's also partially ParaView's fault, who does not know how to handle ghost elements very well. And so if you look into the ParaView forum, you can see that a lot of people are complaining about ghost elements. Anyway, so still the picture is working nicely and there is no more lines. Perfect. Okay. I hope we will be able to solve at least one Poisson equation today, because at this rate, I'm not even sure, but hopefully you are asking questions that are relevant to your research or to your code. So that's best. Anyway, now that there are no questions for now, I will just go back to my original problem. Okay. It's been a long time since we were here, so I will just, this is important stuff, but I will just if macro not run, and if macro, okay, okay, this should work. There is no reason why it shouldn't. Okay, so first thing, if we go back to this morning presentation, I told you that it's if you have a really complex software which does all sorts of fancy discretization, all sorts of fancy block matrices or whatever, again, it can be quite useful to just load PETSI and dump the matrix you are using for example, inside an evolution problem or even in a nonlinear solver, it can be useful to first dump your matrix and then load it in another script, and just to try to see how, for example, a direct solver like MEMS performs, because it can give you insight in the gain you can expect by switching from a sequential to a parallel solver. This is one example of this. And so for that, you need to do format. So it's best to switch to binary. Of course, if you want to do some MATLAB post-processing, MATLAB is the only way to go. But let's say you do binary, and then you do MIMAT is good. And so then you can actually, so I can do it in Windows, actually, I think. No reason why I couldn't. And so now I have the file. So I will remove all the ParaView stuff because it's quite. Is there a way to save the matrix? Okay, I will. Okay, so just give me a sec. So RM, même que je fasse pas de bêtises. Oui, c'est bon ça. Okay. So we have the original MATLAB matrix. Okay. And so now we have the MIMAT, which is the PETSI matrix. So Luca is asking, or Lucas, sorry, I don't know, sorry. He is asking if we can have the matrix in PETSI format. So what's really important here to keep in mind is that in fact this is the PETSI format. This is the PETSI binary format. If you want the PETSI ASCII format, it's just format equals ASCII and then MIMAT ASCII. And so then you can have the exactly same matrix, but in ASCII. Okay. Of course, ASCII means that the file is larger. Let's check this out. MIMAT and MIMAT. Okay, so the ASCII format here is not too bad. And so then you can open up your MIMAT. And so this is how PETSI stores metrics in ASCII format. So it's a row by row, but this is a PETSI matrix, okay? PETSI format, let's say. Of course, it's really important to keep in mind that if you use binary, so for example, MIMAT, okay? So you don't you will not understand anything, of course, but the PETSI people provide MATLAB tools to load such binary matrices in MATLAB, so you are not forced to stick to MATLAB format if you want to post process your matrix in MATLAB, okay? And they also do all the necessary stuff to handle endianness. So for example, if you run your software on a Power9 machine with big Indian, and then you switch to your macOS laptop in a small Indian, everything is handled for you. You don't need to figure out, oh, this is binary, but for some other architectures, and I'm using some other architecture. Okay, so everything is handled by PETSI, so you don't have to worry too much about this. So this is rather technical, but maybe some of you have such technical difficulties, so just to let you know that this is handled by PETSI internally properly. Okay, so we go back to our script. So okay, it's nice to view the matrix, but now it's time to do some actual solving. And so for solving, this is actually as close as the original FreeFame kernel as it gets, in the sense that you can simply write a real int sol equal a minus one times RHS. Okay, so of course here I need to define RHS. So I can just define RHS as a finite element function, and keep in mind here that everything is local. Okay, and so local since VH is defined on TH, which is distributed thanks to build the mesh. Okay. Okay. And so now you say, oh, okay, let's plot the solution. Okay. First, one process, just making sure everything is okay. Okay, I've got an error, nice. Okay. Does it work?
I'm trying to plot an array.
Ah, yes, yes. Thank you. Hein?
Ah oui, oui. Okay. Et puis aussi, le VRHS au mettre des crochets.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. So, just a small remark. So, if you are in the expert tutorial, I guess you've already done FreeFM. And so, if you have done FreeFM and you are not a living god, you probably already have made a syntax error. And so, you end up with this kind of huge output and you say, whoa, 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 what is this? Okay. So, I will give you a small tip, let's say. Unfortunately, this tip only work on macOS or Ubuntu-like machine. I've tried in Windows and it does not work, but that's no big deal. So the trick is quite simple, but it can give you insightful information, hopefully. So I will just relaunch that with eight processes. It will not work. I will have an error, syntax error. Okay. Okay. And so the trick is to use a command which is called C++ filt, which basically translates those low-level C and C++ function name into higher level understandable, hopefully, C++ code. Okay, and so you will see what I mean by that. Okay, and so it's a little bit easier to understand. And so basically, you have all the routines that are understandable by FreeFM with the type you are using. So, for example, you can so if you do the transpose, so KN in FreeFM is the type for one-dimensional arrays, and KNM are two-dimensional arrays, and so you can do the transpose of a KN, KNM, so on and so forth. So it's slightly, it's still tough to understand, but this is the expert session, so hopefully it will help you in the future. And still, it's much more decipherable, at least for me, than those sorts of weird names. But that's my personal taste. And so, thank you, Pierre-Henri and Frédéric. Indeed, the error was that I'm plotting an array which does not make sense. Let's just override the RHS with the solution. Okay.
Non, mais Pierre, ton RHS, c'est, quand tu fais le moins 1, il faut que tu l'appliques à un vecteur.
Ah oui.
Et RHS, merci. Tu l'as défini comme un...
Merci, merci.
Yes. Et bon, okay. Et pour que ça ait sens, il vaudrait mieux que tu calcules un bon RHS. Quoi.
Oui, for the law. OK, thank you. So, of course, I need to do the assembly. And so, the assembly is just as in standard FreeFM, let's say. Sequential FreeFM, at least. OK. And okay, now I think it's okay. Hopefully, we will see sooner than later. Okay. Plot. I guess I'm missing a semicolon. No. Yes. Okay, nice. So finally, the solution of the Poisson equation, but it's not very funny because it's on a single process. And so now let's try something like four process. And oops, okay. I get only the partial solution. And then you have to remember that plot only works on process zero. So you can either do save VTK or you can use the same small machinery I used before, which is something like plot D. Again, D stands for distributed. And so, tac. Vincent, j'ai vu ta question, je vais juste y répondre après. Plot D, tac. And so now, hopefully, everything went. And displays on the complete domain. Yes. Okay. Okay. So, I will just close this window. I will go back to the solution if you want to have a sneak peek, and I will look at Vincent's question. Is the binary format of the save VTK also handled? Okay, so the short answer is no. So Vincent is asking if the binary format of the save VTK is also handled by Petsy. So Petsy indeed handles IO with .vtu, .pvd, .hdf5 format, so on and so forth. But right now, when it comes to mesh IO and its interface with Petsy, we have only implemented the mesh data structure. So if you want to deal with different format of meshes, but we have not yet, and we have yet to handle actual IO of finite element functions. So if you want to save, for example, a field inside FreeFM and then have it read by Petsy in some other packages, right now it's not done. So I hope it answers your question. But okay, I hope it's okay for you. Okay. So finally, the solution of the Poisson equation. So some comments. So right now, again, the solution is performed using Petsy, but there are other tools. So you can use MEMS, FFDDM, HPDDM, whatever. Again, this is in my opinion, the solution which is closest to a sequential code. And so for me, at least, it's the easiest to explain. But there are other alternatives. In any case, there are multiple things that we can highlight. And so one of them is the use of Dirichlet boundary condition. Okay. So in FreeFM, so actually right now I will just use my tutorial because it will be painful to explain. So in FreeFM, you can impose boundary condition in different ways. Okay. And so in particular, by default, we use penalization. Okay. And so what is penalization? Well, it's just some trick, let's say. Quel est l'algorithme utilisé par Petsy? So Frédéric is asking what is the algorithm used by Petsy. And so but I think I'm using the, I mean, here for sure, I'm using the default Petsy solver. And so I will just show you what it is. And it should be something really bad. Which is a block Jacobi preconditioned by incomplete LU. Let's just check quickly. Okay. Okay. And so indeed, it's not the best. It's even the worst. But actually, it's converging, so that's not a problem. So by default, in fact, the preconditioner used by Petsy is block Jacobi preconditioned by ALU, so incomplete factorization with zero level of fill in. So it's quite a bad preconditioner, and in practice we will probably discuss some more about preconditioner later in this session or tomorrow. But yes, okay, I think it answers your question. So in fact, it's quite interesting that you asked this question, because it goes nice with this slide. So as I said, by default we use penalization, and so for the penalization we rely on a trick, which is that we put. So here I'm decomposing my matrix A into the set of unknowns associated to Dirichlet boundary condition, so JD. And the set of unknowns which are not associated to Dirichlet unknowns. Okay, and so by default, when we do penalization, we put 10 to the power of 30 on the diagonal with the Dirichlet boundaries, Dirichlet degrees of freedom, and we multiply as well the boundary value. And this explains why, if you do, for example, stuff like let's do something like cout rhs.lnft, So the infinity norm of the vector. You will probably be surprised at first, if you don't know anything about penalization, that you have some really large values. Okay? So just making sure. Yes. Okay, so you see, oh la la. But don't worry, it's supposed to be under control. Okay. So I'm using the word supposed to be under control because penalization is good when you are dealing with direct method, but as soon as you switch to iterative solver, or as soon as you compute quantities based on the residual or on the matrix norm, you can get some rather strange information. For example, in PETSI, there is a way to automatically compute for you the residual. And so I think it's something like, so I will actually go back here and I will remove KSP view, and instead it's view final residual, I think. Okay. And so if I do that, you will probably see something a little bit strange, but maybe not. It all depends on the behavior of the TGVs. Yes, okay. So you see KSP final norm of residual, whoa! And so if you see that, you can say, okay, my algorithm is not converging. But this is only because we have TGVs. And so whenever you compute something like the stiffness matrix time, so A times X, minus, for example, the right hand side. If this is not resolved exactly, you will get some small epsilon, and so epsilon times 10 to the power of 30 is not equal to epsilon, and so you get a terribly large residual. So of course, there is one way to deal with this, and this is through the This is through some other kind of elimination or directly boundary condition way. You impose directly boundary condition through some other way. And you can do that either through non-symmetric elimination. And so if you do non-symmetric elimination, you basically remove the lower block associated to directly boundaries of freedom, and you put the identity on the diagonal. Okay. And so this can be imposed using the TGV equal minus one. And of course, this must be done in both the variational formulation and the bilinear form and the linear form. Okay, oops, I quit my script. Okay, so TGV equal minus one. And so now we can relaunch the same script. And you will see that on the screen, the solution is exactly the same, okay? But now we have a correct residual, okay? So Frederick Hecht will always tell you, oh, TGV is wonderful, but be careful, in some scenarios, using the default values of the TGV can be quite misleading or tricky, let's say. Okay. So there is another way to impose directly values, and it's through symmetric elimination. And so for symmetric elimination, you can use TGV equal minus two, but you have to be careful because we only handle with the bilinear form. We don't do the lifting of the directly data inside the linear form, okay? So be careful, please only use symmetric elimination when you have homogeneous boundary condition. So I will show you what I mean by that. Here, if I put TGV minus two, TGV minus two, I have non-homogeneous boundary condition, non-homogeneous, TGV minus two will break. Okay, so I have the I don't have the correct value. But now, if I impose instead, I did that on my Mac OS, but you can get the same result on Windows, of course. If I do that in Windows, with homogeneous directly boundary condition. Now I get the correct value and the correct residual. Okay? So be really careful with how you deal with TGVs. And so in some cases, it may be beneficial to not use penalization. But at the same time, if you don't use penalization, it may be tricky to keep a symmetric system if you don't have homogeneous boundary condition. Okay. So now we can actually go back to what we did in the beginning. Okay, and so I will define my macro not run, and so now this code will run, and I will show you that we get. So I'm just taking the same code as before, but in the previous code, I was just plotting the global solution, the global vector from some garbage local data. Now I want to get the global solution from the local solution of the Poisson equation. And so I can just do loc equal RHS. So this can, yes, loc equal RHS. And so RHS is the solution I get from the Poisson equation. Okay. So I will just go back to non-homogeneous. And so I need to switch back to TGV equal minus one. Okay. And so now, hopefully, I get the solution of the Poisson equation. So let's crank up the number of process. Tac. Okay. So I get a correct residual. Okay. You can see that the L infinity norm of my right hand side is not 10 to the power of 30, so I'm not using TGV, but that's okay. And so this is the solution plotted with the domain decomposition. So this is a distributed plot. And so now let's cross our fingers. I have done everything to compute the global solution on the global mesh using the new to old technique. So this is with the change numbering. So I'm showing that the unknowns associated to ghost elements are properly set to zero when not owned by the local process. And so when you do the summation with all reduce, we get the correct Poisson solution on a single mesh. So if you want to do post-processing like mesh adaptation, stuff like that, it can be done in a sequential manner. Okay. So of course, if you have questions, please let us know. We have like 30 minutes left, but we didn't do any breaks or whatever. So what I think we can do quickly, I mean not so quickly, but at least what we can try to explain, let's say, are some different preconditioners that we can use actually for the Poisson equation, because we've done everything for the Poisson equation, but we have yet to play with the, for example, the different solvers. So maybe I will try that now. Again, there are different ways to solve a system such as A sol equal RHS, and so here I'm focusing on the Petsy machinery. But if you want, you can use also. Oh, sorry, there is a question, so let's answer that. Actually, is there any way to calculate the derivative of sol locally? For example, so this is another interesting question. And it goes hand in hand with the question of Mojtaba from earlier in the tutorial. So I'm sorry, I will probably mispronounce your name. So Chichao Wang is asking if it's possible to compute the derivative of the solution locally. And so, in fact, yes, it is possible. And this is one of the nice advantage of using distributed finite element with ghost element. Okay. So why this is an advantage? Because you know that you have some overlap, and so you know that the solution is consistent on all subdomains. And so you can actually compute the derivative locally. And so I will actually show you how it's done. So I will plot. I will do this here. VH derivative. And so you want me to compute derivative equal dx of RHS. Okay. So maybe I will just stop trying to be fancy, and I will just define a new. So instead of defining this function, this as an array of double, I will define just a finite element function, and so I don't have to do all these copy inside the RHS function. I can just leave RHS alone. Okay, that will be easier to decipher for you. So let's say I want to compute the derivative of dx sol. So what this will do is it will compute locally the derivative of the solution everywhere. But of course, just as before, if we do this, we'll actually do this right now, so I will not plot the rest. If I run this, so there is also an output of lmft, which is completely useless. No more C out, I think. Okay. So if I do this, so this is the solution. What have I done? Maybe not save. I'm not plotting the correct solution, sorry. plot of derivative. And this is not macro. Huh? I have to comment this. Or I can do if macro not run. I put zero. I think this would work. Okay, so now I think I'm plotting the correct solution. So I think it's... So in this case, the solution is still consistent among subdomains, and so I want to show you that it can be dangerous. But for this example, it's not dangerous. Why is that? I don't know. But anyway, in this case, everything is working nicely. What I wanted to tell you is that it may happen that the derivative on the border of the ghost elements are actually not consistent among subdomains. And so if you want to get a consistent derivative, you can do exactly as before, and that is make sure that you exchange the value through the partition of unity. And so this is done using the exactly as before exchange but this time it's not u, it's derivative. And so this will make sure that the derivative is consistent among the subdomains. So I hope this answers your question. But of course, for computing quantities such as the derivative of the global function, it's much more efficient to compute the derivative subdomain-wise, and then make sure that the derivative is consistent among subdomains by doing a call to exchange. So you should not have to bother using this N2O routine just for computing the derivative afterwards. So I think you get it. So that's nice. So just making sure that I'm not saying nonsense, I will just rerun the exact same problem. But it was consistent before, so it will still be consistent. Again, it's the nice property of the partition of unity. If you have something which is consistent before, it will be consistent after, And if you have something which is not consistent before using the partition of unity, it will be consistent after the partition, after using the partition of unity, after post-processing with the small routine exchange. Okay, so so with respect to the minus one call, so in this example, it's taking a little bit of time to get the solution, at least on Windows, and so I think that we can I think that it comes from the fact that the we are using an iterative solver, and so we can actually get the number of we can get the number of at least the convergence reason by using the parameter KSP. I think it's converge reason. There is the zoom shot. Oh, okay, so you're not seeing my screen. Oh, this will be painful. I can try to resize my VM window. Okay. KSP converge reason. Okay, so it's not that bad. I think it's mostly because my Windows VM is kind of overheating. So you can see here that it's converging in 66 iterations. And the convergence is because the relative tolerance is the relative tolerance criterion is reached. Okay, so whenever you start going parallel, or even whenever you have a parallel code and you want to try to improve it, my first advice, my first and most important advice is to always stick to exact factorization. And so you should be able to do that using a simple parameter, which is PC type, so preconditioner type LU. Okay. And so now it should be maybe not faster, but at least it will converge really much better. And in fact, it's converged in one iteration because we have the exact preconditioner. Oh, okay, so it's still the derivative, so it's kind of misleading. It's not the solution at all. So I will just comment that for the moment. Oh, no, I will just copy paste that. And I will plot the solution instead of the derivative. Okay. Okay, so just making sure that we get the correct solution. Yes, it looks like the Poisson problem solved with. So in this case, if you want to know some of the details of what's going on, you can put KSP view. And so basically, whenever you solve a linear system with PETSI, you have a Krylov subspace method, which is a KSP, to which a preconditioner is attached. And so this is PC. Okay. And so when you do KSP view, you'll see details about both the Krylov subspace method used and the preconditioner used. Okay. And so here, we can see that the default KSP type is the GMRS, but here it does not matter because we will be using a direct solver, so it will converge in one iteration. But we can see that for the PC, we are using an LU factorization, and the LU factorization is performed by MEMS. Okay, and so again, this is a nice proof that you can get most of the packages working on both macOS and Windows, even though it's not so trivial to get Fortran running on Windows. And so MEMS, of course, is a Fortran package. So just to make sure, I will now do the same exactly on macOS. And so KSP view, PC type, LU. And so hopefully this will work. Okay, so and so yes, it works as well on macOS, and so that's nice. So I won't do an in-depth introduction to preconditioner. Maybe we will focus slightly more on that tomorrow. We'll have to discuss this with Pierre-Henri. But you can try other alternatives. So first, let me just show you the importance of the TGV. So for example, if instead of having a non-homogeneous boundary condition, you this time have an homogeneous boundary condition, okay, you can again switch to TGV equal minus 2, okay? And so why is this important? Well, because now, instead of using an LU factorization, you can do a Cholesky factorization. And so the Cholesky factorization, of course, if you think about large problem, asymptotically, it performs twice lower number of flops, and it's also much less costlier to store in memory. Okay, so you can of course just change from Cholesky to LU, and so you can see now that okay, so the MEMS output is a little bit a mouthful, let's say. So this is all MEMS, but the PETSI output is slightly shorter. So you can see okay, type Cholesky and all is good. Okay, so this is basically the direct solver. For direct solver, I think I'm covering the basics, but it's good enough. If you think about Poisson equation, they are really much more efficient tool if you think about really large scale computing. And those tools are basically multi-grid or domain decomposition method. And so we have quite a few alternatives inside the PETSI, and we provide the proper examples inside FreeFM. If you want to tune the parameters, you can just copy paste the value that we put in place. So one of the most advanced preconditioners when it comes to Poisson, scalar Poisson, is actually Boomer AMG, which is part of the Hyper package. And so if you want to use that, you can just say PC type Hyper, okay? And so I think it's installed in your Windows installation. I'm just checking. Okay, so it's work. Yes, you basically get a really good convergence. So you can see here three iterates, but of course the problem is tiny and there are no heterogeneities and the mesh is really nice. So it's almost like a direct solver, but that's about it. You can also use GAMG, which is another algebraic multigrid solver. I think for this problem, it's a piece of cake as well. Okay. Maybe slightly more iterates, but yes, a little bit more iterates, but still the problem is really small. Okay. What's more to say for today? Important stuff to keep in mind. Tac tac, TGV, VAREF, SET. Okay, maybe I will just do a quick remark. So this morning I talked a little bit about composable solvers, and so if you're not very familiar with this terminology, I think it's important that I show you the following, because it's really important for me, at least, that when I spent countless hours developing a linear solver, it's easy for me to use it in, for example, a non-linear solver or an eigenvalue problem solver. Okay, and so this is the idea behind PETSI and all the machinery. For example, SLEPSI or the field preconditioner, is that if you have something that works quite well for your linear problem, you should be able to easily use it, for example, inside an eigenvalue problem solver. And so I will actually try to solve the to get the eigenvalue associated to the Poisson problem using SLEPSI. Okay? And so actually, for this script, it shouldn't be much harder than just, actually, I'm not sure it will work, but it's no big deal, of doing, so now you need to load SLEPSI, but it's probably already loaded in your installation. And so in SLEPSI, when you want to solve linear eigenvalue problem, it's called EPS solve. Okay? And I think, maybe I'm wrong, I hope I'm not wrong, you can just do EPS solve A. Okay? So let's try. Does this work? So I will switch to my Mac. Okay. So it seems to work, but you don't see anything. And that's because I'm not saying much. So for example, you can do sparams EPS view. So when you solve linear system, you have KSP and PC. And when you solve linear eigenvalue problem, you have EPS. So you can do EPS view, you can do EPS NEV equal 5, if you want the 5 smallest eigenpairs. So EPS, smallest real part, I think. And so this is where the PETSI and the SLEPSI manual comes in handy. You can, in most of the time, just Google so EPS smallest real part. Okay, so you can do SLEPSI EPS solve some better way. So you click there, and so EPS setup EPS solve. So it's a little bit hide and seek, let's say. So I think which eigenpair, yes, set which eigenpair, tac. And so it's smallest magnitude, okay, or smallest real. Ah, okay, so there is no part at the end. So just OSPS smallest real. Okay. And again, you have to think about the fact that we try to, so whether you think about FreeFM or PETSI and SLEPSI, we want to make it the simplest for you to try your favorite tools. And so, for example, let's say you want to export your eigenvalues to MATLAB. So I don't remember by heart. So I think it's EPS. I will just use my history view values, I think. Yes, EPS view values ASCII MATLAB. Okay. And so now let's just plug and play with this. Does it work? It seems to work. Okay. And so, so yes, you should be able to recognize the SLEPSI output, which somehow looks like the PETSI output. But yes, again, the idea is that you can use most of the PETSI machinery inside SLEPSI, and you don't have to play around with the parameters. You can just use the same linear solver parameters inside SLEPSI. So for example, here I'm not using any kind of spectral transformation, but it's actually better to use something like a shift and invert method, which is the default when you are using RPAC, for example, which is another eigenvalue problem available in FreeFM, ST type, shift and invert. Okay. I think this will error out, and we will see why, and we will try to decipher why. Okay, this is in fact erroring out. And so again, this is a nice instance of an output message of PETSI or SLEPSI. So you need to go back up a little bit, but you can see that SLEPSI is telling us shift and invert technique requires a target which set C EPS which eigenpairs, for instance, EPS target 0, EPS target magnitude. Okay, so most of the error message should look like that, and it should be easy for you to debug on your own a PETC or a SLEPC script. Of course, if it's not the case, please let us know, and we will help you out gladly. But here, basically, what SLEPC is telling us is that we cannot use smallest real. We need to use a target zero and then closest to zero. So target magnitude. And so now we should get the proper value. Okay. Okay. And so we get actually exactly the same value, but this time we are using a shift and invert technique. And so it means that we have a spectral transformation. We need the factorization of the matrix. And so this is why you get some mumps outputs because mumps is being used internally by SLEPC, PETC, and so on and so forth. And so, what we can do is make sure that it's working on Windows as well, for example. So PC type LU. You can use GNG for this problem for SLEPC as well. It's not too complicated. Okay, so this is the linear problem. And then you have the six successive Kryloff-Schur iteration inside the SLEPC loop. And so hopefully it will converge sooner than later. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's converging. Okay, so I think again, it's because my Windows machine is a little bit slow, but you get the idea. And so, of course, you have a lot of diagnosis tools. So, for example, so hopefully I'm not wrong, but it's something like EPS, error backward, or error forward, ASCII info detail. I think it's like that. Info detail. ASCII info detail. Okay. Tac. Okay. No. EPS error for. C'était quoi? EPS error absolute. Error absolute. Alors, on va essayer. EPS error. Okay. So it computes automatically the error. So actually, so there is one life-saving command which is help, but of course it prints help for everything PETC related, and so it's quite huge. So I will show you now. Get ready. And so you are basically. You are basically fed with PETC messages, so it's quite tricky, but let me try to see the correct error. Help, grep, error. Error absolute, yes. Okay. So just to show you, I've printed the absolute error. You can also have the relative error. I don't know why it was not working before. Maybe I did a small typo. Oh, I put EPS view error relative. My bad. Okay, so those are the successive Kryloff-Schur. And so you have SLEPC automatically computing the errors associated to each eigenpairs. And so just to conclude, I will go back to the beginning of the talk with respect to the linear solvers. I'm just realizing that I have the night shift turned on, so you see my screen in yellow, I think. So I'll switch that back on. So let's try to go back to the initial TGV values. And so this is a prime example of why I'm not a really big fan of such TGVs, because now if I run the same script, It will converge probably to the same solution. Okay. Indeed. But now you can see that my errors are completely weird, and that's just because of the TGVs inside A. So you do AX with A with 10 to the power of 30 minus the eigenvalue times the eigenvector. It's supposed to be close to machine epsilon, but because of the 10 to the power of 30 inside your A, SLEPSI is actually saying, "Ooh, this is weird," but it's not weird, but you have to know about these little details of TGVs. And so I think this will nicely wrap this up for today. So thank you everyone for your attention. Again, if you want to get in touch with us, you can go on in GitHub. You can post issues or create pull requests if you want to commit to the source code. Of course, there is also the community, so community FreeFM. You can ask questions, and so we will make sure that we answer to you. Okay. And I think we will resume the user's presentation tomorrow morning, and I don't remember the exact time. 9 a.m. with Atsushi Suzuki. And so I think I will let this tutorial sink in your minds. And again, if you have questions, maybe I will not answer tonight because I need to rest a little bit. But I think either Pierre-Henri or me tomorrow, we will be really happy to help you. And we hope that we can help you turn your script into parallel FreeFM. I will make sure that the recording is available on the web. Some of the slides I've presented are available on my own tutorial. And so if you want to have access to the tutorial, you can just type Jolivet FreeFM on the web. And so it's the first link actually, I think. Okay. Yes. And so if you want to have access to the EDP, you just remove the main.pdf, and so you have access to all the .edp with color-coded sources. So it's easier for you to go through, hopefully, and you should be able to run the code on your machines. Thank you, everyone. I hope I have answered to everyone. Thank you very much for your kind words. Of course, if you have questions now, maybe I will answer for 10 minutes, but then I need to get back to my wife. So I'm sorry, I will need to put an end to this discussion. But yes, I hope it was helpful, and we will see you tomorrow if you don't have any questions. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Pierre. See you tomorrow.
See you. Okay, I will stop the recording now, just if you want to have some private talks or whatever.